This is a copyrighted work. Unauthorized copying or distribution is a crime punishable by up to 5 years in prison and a fine of $250,000.
Scholastic Audio presents Stranded by Nikki Shannon Smith, read by Ahnya O'Riordan. For the Black Campfire Girls, past and present of Oakland, California. 1. Walking into Central Park felt like coming home. No walls, no tall buildings, and no cars honking at you for crossing the street too slow. It was like Manhattan had disappeared. All I could see was grass, trees, water, birds, and blue sky. The only thing that made outside better was being on the big fifth grade field trip with my three best friends on our second to last day of school. "You guys, I can't believe we're about to be in middle school," Sienna said. Carlos's eyes bulged at the thought. "I don't want to think about that yet," said Kimberly. "We're almost on summer vacation." She gave Sienna a high five. "And we're outside," I said, breathing it in. "You guys want to walk over to one of the lakes? I've read there are fish and turtles." "Let's play frisbee first," said Kimberly. Carlos and Sienna nodded. "We could play frisbee anywhere. I wanted to check out the wildlife." "Can we go to the lake later?" I asked. My friends nodded, so frisbee it was. The only one who could actually aim, throw, and catch was Kimberly. Sienna, Carlos, and I ran around on the grass laughing and fetching like dogs. When Carlos threw the frisbee all the way into a grove of elm trees, I was glad. Maybe I would spot a bark beetle. They were spreading Dutch elm disease to some of the elm trees. When I found the frisbee, I didn't notice any beetles, but I did notice something in the dirt. I squatted down and inspected it. "Look, an owl pellet!" I yelled, running back to the group with it cradled in my palm. "It looks like poop," Kimberly said. "That's nasty," said Sienna. "Throw it back in the woods and go clean your hands." I rolled my eyes at them and said, "It's not poop. Owls eat and then they cough up what they can't digest. It's bones and fur from the owl's prey. Isn't that cool?" Carlos frowned and shook his head. "I loved my friends, but they were definitely city folks. They would be totally out of place in the wilderness." "You're so weird," said Kimberly. "Where's the frisbee?" "Weird? Why? Because I like nature as much as you like sports?" I crossed my arms and smirked at her. "Okay, that's fair," she said. "But where is the frisbee?" I laughed. I was so excited about the pellet, I had forgotten the frisbee, so I ran back to get it. I dropped the pellet and stared up into the branches of the elm tree. I could barely spot the owl asleep on one of the highest branches. If I had brought my nature journal, I could have sat under the tree for hours watching and sketching. "Ava," Kimberly yelled, "you have to throw the frisbee." I laughed, threw the frisbee to Carlos, and watched it sail sideways over his head. Toot, toot! A double toot on a teacher's whistle meant, "Come back to the meeting spot right now for lunch." We ran back and waited for our teacher, Mr. Mack, to count us and make sure nobody was missing. Sienna took a pink bedsheet out of her backpack, and Kimberly helped her spread it out. "Good idea," said Kimberly. "The grass makes me itch." Even though the pink sheet was kind of extra, I was glad she brought it. There was one thing in nature I did not like. Ants. They always showed up uninvited and ruined things. We ate our sandwiches and traded cookies and chips while we talked about summer. Kimberly was going to 4 different sport camps. If you asked me, they weren't really camps because they were at the high school. Camp meant being outside in the wilderness. I would never say that to Kimberly, though. I'm doing my own video series this summer, Sienna announced. I'm going to read books and record myself doing reviews. Then I'll post them on my YouTube channel. Kimberly was definitely going to be a big-time athlete someday, but I didn't know what Sienna would be. One time, she told me she was going to be an influencer. I'm calling this the summer of relaxation, Carlos said, looking proud of himself. I'm playing video games, sleeping in, and watching TV. No activities, no people, no worries. I didn't bother to tell them my plans because I didn't have any. I didn't play sports, and I only played video games if I was at Carlos's house. I was not spending summer on the computer. I would be stuck in our two-bedroom apartment with six people and lots of arguing over who sat on the toilet for too long. Mama would be working at the salon most of the day. My dad would spend his own summer vacation in chauffeur mode instead of math teacher mode. When we weren't taking Alex to his summer league basketball stuff, I'd be trying to hide on the top bunk so Eric and Andre couldn't bug me. A big brother was bad enough without the twins running around nonstop. Summer was going to stink. The only way I was going to have any fun was to make a tent out of Sienna's pink sheet and pretend I was in the Adirondack Mountains like Auntie Raven. Auntie Raven was my idol, even though I only saw her when she came to our house for Christmas. Her gifts were the best. 2 years ago, she gave me a book about plants and animals of the Adirondacks. Last year, she gave me my very own mess kit with little pots, bowls, and silverware that nested into a carrying bag. And Auntie Raven didn't care what anyone said. She wanted to live alone in a cabin in the woods, and that's exactly what she did. What I didn't understand was why Mama never visited her own twin sister. They were total opposites, but that shouldn't stop Mama. I'd certainly visit if I could. It was probably nothing but fresh air and blue sky and all kinds of animals in peace and quiet. I bet you could even hear owls hooting at night. You guys want to help me practice football? Kimberly said after we finished lunch. I don't want to look like I don't know what I'm doing at camp. What about the lake? I asked. Let's do that right after football, Kimberly said. I shrugged, my friends nodded, and Kimberly got a football from the PE bag. Okay, she said. I'm going to pass it quarterback style, so be ready. Kimberly was strong, and every time she threw, she had to yell, "Go long!" which meant the ball was about to go past you. If you wanted to catch it, you had to back up. A lot. Carlos tripped over his own feet running backward and fell. I fumbled most of the passes. We laughed the whole time, but I kept wishing my friends were willing to explore with me the way they were willing to play sports for Kimberly. The pass to Sienna was the farthest of all. Carlos and I watched as Kimberly launched the ball into the air. "Go long!" she yelled. "I am!" Sienna yelled back. Her eyes stayed on the ball, and she continued to back up closer and closer to the lake. I opened my mouth to warn her about how close she was, but before I could say anything, splash! Sienna sailed backward into the water. Sienna screamed and bobbed up and down, "Help!" The more Sienna thrashed around, the farther out she drifted. "Try not to panic," I yelled. "Can you swim?" Sienna didn't answer. Kimberly, Carlos, and I ran to the edge of the lake. "Somebody has to save her," said Carlos as he took a step back from the edge. "She's freaking out," I said, "and that's going to make things worse." "Help!" Sienna screamed again. "I'm not getting in that dirty water," said Kimberly. Sienna disappeared under the surface and then bobbed up again. There was no time to worry about dirty water. I once saw a drowning boy get rescued from a lake on the news. I knew what to do. "Go get Mr. Mack," I yelled at my friends. I splashed into the lake, then dove and swam toward Sienna. She grabbed my neck and her weight pushed me down. I pumped my legs to stay afloat. "Sienna, try to get on my back," I yelled. I turned my back toward her and pulled her arms to help her get behind me. As soon as she was back there, she wrapped her arms around my neck again. I pulled them off and put her hands on my shoulders so she didn't choke me to death while I saved her life. Once we were in position, I started to swim toward the shore. I couldn't believe my eyes. The entire fifth grade and the teachers were at the edge of the lake watching us. Sienna was still in panic mode, which made her feel heavy, so I took a deep breath and put my face in the water. I kicked as hard as I could. When I came up for air, I heard everyone chanting, "Ava! Ava!" Finally, I felt the bottom of the lake. "Put your feet down, Sienna. You can stand up now." We climbed out of the water into the crowd. Sienna coughed and frowned down at her wet clothes. Kimberly ran to get the pink sheet so Sienna could wrap herself up in it. "Are you okay?" asked Mr. Mack. Sienna nodded and said, "Yes, thanks to Ava. She saved my life." "You're a hero," said Carlos. He grabbed my arm and raised it in the air like I was Muhammad Ali or something. I smiled at him and thought to myself, not a hero, just queen of the wilderness. Auntie Raven would be proud of me. Mr. Mack made us sit on a bench in the sun to dry off. "Stay away from that lake," he said. "You guys smell like a swamp," said Kimberly. Sienna frowned at her. "I could have died in there." If I hadn't gone in after Sienna, she actually might have drowned. She had totally panicked. She would never make it in the wilderness. I would, though. If I ever had a chance to go to the wilderness. And now I wanted to go more than ever. I tried to imagine what my parents would do if I asked them if I could stay with Auntie Raven. It could be a simple no or a long explanation no. Either way, it would be a no. Then I'd be stuck at home and mad at my parents. But at least if I asked, it would mean I had tried. I could do it at the dinner table. We always talked about important things at dinner. "Can I please stay with Auntie Raven this summer? Would it be okay if I spend the summer with Auntie Raven? Can I ask you a question? Is it okay if I go to the Adirondacks to stay with Auntie Raven this summer?" I was going to do it, and then I'd hold my breath and wait for their answer. "No. Absolutely not. There is no way you're going to live out in the middle of nowhere." Hopefully, it wouldn't be worse than that. Hopefully, I wouldn't cry. 2. Everyone was already home by the time I walked into our apartment. Daddy and Alex had a half day at school, so Daddy had already picked up the twins from daycare. I had completely forgotten that Mama was leaving the salon early so she could do my hair for graduation. "Ava!" Eric yelled. He tackled my waist and gave me a big hug. I know I wasn't supposed to pick favorites, but Eric was my favorite brother. Whenever I read a nature book with lots of pictures, he climbed up to the top bunk bed with me so I could read it to him. "How was your day?" Daddy asked. Before I could answer him, Mama asked, "How was the field trip?" "It was fine," I said. I hoped that answer satisfied them both because I was suddenly very nervous. All the time I had spent practicing my lines on the way home went out the window. "Put your things down and set the table," Mama said. "Dinner is almost ready. We're eating early so I can start your hair." My mouth went dry. I thought I had another hour before dinner and the "I want to spend summer with Auntie Raven" conversation. I nodded at Mama and did what she said. Everyone else jumped into action too. Alex poured our drinks. Daddy took the twins to wash their hands so they would actually use soap, and Mama put a big bowl of spaghetti in the middle of the table. As soon as we sat down, Alex started talking about his summer league basketball team. "I can't wait to start," he said. "I'm about to be dunking on fools left and right." He did a dunking motion in his seat. He probably would be dunking on people all summer because he was good, because he practiced all the time. Because he got to do what he loved every day and nobody second-guessed it, ever. Basketball wasn't weird. But apparently loving nature was. Last summer, the Central Park Rangers had a lottery and the winners got to camp overnight in the park. I tried to get Mama and Daddy to enter, but they wouldn't. Mama said she wasn't sleeping outside. Daddy said we were better off safe and sound at home. Alex laughed at me and told me black folks don't camp, which was a stupid thing to say since her own aunt lived in the mountains. Auntie Raven was the one who gave me the nature journal. Ava, Daddy said, you're a little quiet. Are you looking forward to summer? I wasn't expecting it to go down like this, with a direct question. I swallowed my spaghetti without chewing. No, I said. Everyone but Andre stopped eating. Andre kept slurping up noodles. Mama, Daddy, Alex, and Eric stared at me. My parents looked concerned. Alex was smirking even though he didn't know what I was going to say. Eric was curious as usual. It was like on TV when...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.